Professor Albert Ziegler is Chief Professor of Educational Psychology and Research on Excellence at the University of Erlangen-Nuremberg in Germany. He is the founding director of Statewide Counseling and Research Center for the Gifted. He has published approximately 250 books, chapters and articles in the fields of talent development and educational psychology. Presently, he serves as the Secretary General of the International Research Association for Talent Development and Excellence, as Vice President of the European Council for High Ability, and as Chairman of the European Talent Support Network. He is editor and chief of High Ability Studies, the scholarly journal of the European Council for High Ability. Albert Ziegler has honored our Congress as a special guest. Under the achievement of gifted students, diagnosis and attitude styles, I'm inviting Mr. Albert Ziegler to the stage to make his presentation.
Good morning. The good news for all of them who are already here is gifted persons manage better their time, so they are here in time, they don't come late, so you have a good chance also to be gifted who are already here. My topic is today underachievement. This is my city, Nuremberg. Some photos of Nuremberg. Several scholars from Turkey have already visited me in my lab. Two will come this year again, and we do research together. And I also report some data we have collected here in Turkey. Topic today is underachievement. There are many definitions of underachievement out there. I give a very straightforward definition, and do not say this is the only right one, but it is one definition we can use for this presentation. A gifted underachiever is someone gifted who exhibits unexpectedly low achievements. And there's one word in this definition that is not so clear. This is unexpectedly. What expectations are meant here? So look, for example, at this cartoon. My teacher says I'm an underachiever, but I think she's an over-expecter. So she is expecting too much. How do we decide on these expectations? And basically, there are three different approaches to underachievement I want to introduce very shortly with some definitions. The first definition can be called the universal definition of underachievement. And this simply means we are all underachievers, because every one of us can do better. Think back at school, you could have learned a little bit more, be a little bit more motivated. Your parents maybe could have supported you a little bit more. So in this regard, every one of us is an underachiever. That doesn't help so much, this definition, but it shows something at least. The most common and most frequently used definition is the discrepancy definition of underachievement. And this usually means that there is a significant big discrepancy between IQ and school achievements. To put it very simple, the person has a very high IQ but very low achievements. So this person is an underachiever. There's a third definition I like very much. This is a more modern definition. This is the learning resource definition. And the learning resource definition has three components. Component number one, this is a person who has above average a lot of learning resources. Come later to the term learning resources, what is this specifically? So the person has a lot of learning resources. But this person is missing one or two of the learning resources, and so because these resources are essential, maybe achievements are impaired, but what is also important, these learning resources can be remedied. That means, although the person is lacking now at this moment the learning resources, there are ways to make up for this and to give the person these resources. I talk very briefly, very shortly, only about identification, because I think this is not so much the interesting part of underachievement. And I focus first on the universal definition, how will they identify a person who is underachieving, and the discrepancy definition, the high IQ and lower achievement definition. Identification of underachievement according to the universal definition. The universal definition says everybody is an underachiever. Actually, then it is no problem at all to identify an underachiever, because we are all underachievers, so we don't have to look around for it. We just have to look in the mirror, and then we see an underachiever according to this definition. More tricky and more interesting is already the identification of underachiever according to the discrepancy definition. There are many methods out there in the literature, and you find them easily, but it is basically always in three steps done. First, measure the IQ of a person. Second, measure achievement of the person. And then you have some criterion. I talk in a minute about that. And you compare IQ and achievement. And if the discrepancy is too big, you call this person an underachiever. How do you measure the IQ? Of course, you need an excellent IQ test. And it should be usually an IQ test which was developed in your country. 5 years ago, as far as I know, you didn't have one. But now you are in a very lucky position. Maybe you know this man. This is Professor Sack from Anapolu University. He has presented his intelligence scale at international conferences. So I know this intelligence scale very well. And so, lucky you, Turkey, you have an intelligence test which you can use. So you would, for example, first apply this IQ test. How do you measure achievements? Basically, two ways. First way, you use school achievements. They have an advantage and a disadvantage. The advantage is, if you use school achievements, they have what you call a high curricular validity. So in a school test, it's just tested what really was a topic of in the classroom. The disadvantage is, from the point of measurement, school achievements are not marks or report cards and so on, are not so well suited. They have some disadvantages in terms of measurement. Standardized school achievement tests, the advantage, excellent psychometric qualities. These are really good tests, like intelligence tests, measurement quality is very high, but they are standardized, so you apply it in whole Turkey, the same, let's say, mathematics test, and the curricula validity might suffer from this. So, in many research studies, you look at the marks and the report cards, plus you use a standardized test. The third step, then you decide on a criterion of underachievement and apply it. I think one of the most common is a person who has an IQ higher than 130 and achievements below average is called an underachiever, but you find all kinds of criteria, for example, also achievement one standard deviation below IQ, and the IQ must be at least 130, or the IQ must be among the upper 2% in the IQ distribution, and achievements below average. The problem with all these criteria is they are kind of artificial, but the advantage is if you decide on one, you simply have to decree on one, then measurement of underachievement is straightforward and it's easy to find out who is an underachiever. The question is, do we really need an IQ test, and do we really need to compare it to standardized achievement tests, or can't we simply ask teachers or the parents, is your kid gifted or underachieving? And here is a study that was very shocking to us. It's an older study, but you find it in every country, and I know you have here unpublished data in Turkey that are very similar to these results. What was this study? First, students were tested. These students we are now talking about are all in the upper 2% of the intelligence distribution. They are, according to this definition of giftedness, really gifted, high intelligence, very high intelligence. Then we asked teachers, parents, and the students themselves, what do you think? Where are you in the intelligence distribution? How many of the students are more intelligent than you? The right answer would now be, I am in the top 2% of the intelligence distribution, or parents should say, my kid is among the top 2%, it's gifted. But where do they place the kids? We had here achiever and underachiever. The achiever, the teachers thought 20% of the other students are more intelligent than these highly gifted students. Very similar result among the parents. Also, a similar result among the students. They underestimate the intelligence, the giftedness of the students dramatically. So, you see, it's really necessary if you use this discrepancy definition. I said you don't have to, there are other alternatives. But if you use this discrepancy definition, then you really need an IQ test, because parents, teachers, and the students themselves are not able to see what kind of giftedness they have. So, causes of underachievement, some good and some bad news. The good news for us, we are complex beings. So, for example, a child is much more complex than a car. Okay, maybe this, of course, this is no surprise to you, but we are talking today about underachievement. Maybe you expect from me that I tell you in 10 minutes how to fix underachievement, what you can do about underachievement. A car is not so complex like a human being, and you would never expect that I can tell you in 10 minutes how to repair a car, which is broken. So it's complex to remedy underachievement, to plan interventions with underachievement. But there are also some more good news. Fortunately, some causes of underachievement are more common than the others. And fortunately, we know also of some training programs and interventions that work pretty well. Still, please keep in mind, if I tell you now some of the causes, there are many more causes of underachievement. And just knowing a few doesn't help you. You need professional knowledge when you want to encounter, to remedy in your country underachievement. Let me first start with some what we call fixed attributes. Fixed attributes are attributes you cannot change in a way. Many think we cannot change the attributes, so the attributes are directly responsible for underachievement. Directly responsible. And that's simply wrong. Let me show you this. You cannot change your gender. You are male, you are female. But already at age 6, something happens what we really do not like. Girls begin to avoid activities said to be for children who are really, really smart. This is nothing that is necessary for the girls. It's how we bring them up. It's socialization, education. It's a stereotype we give to them. We tell boys much easier that you can achieve anything in your life than we tell the girls. So, if girls are in some fields underachieving, like physics, like chemistry, it's not because they are girls, but because we are socializing them in a certain way. Another fixed attribute you cannot really change is birth order. I hope you are all firstborns. Study has, for example, found that firstborns score higher than their siblings in IQ tests as early as age 1. So, beginning from age 1, we find IQ differences between the firstborns, the secondborns, the thirdborns, and so on, and it goes down. Is this because they are later born? No, that's not because they are later born. Studies have found that this result is due to extra mental stimulation. So parents have more time for the older children, for the older siblings, and this is the reason. So you see again here, this is something second-born children are a little bit underachieving, third-born children even a little bit more. But this underachievement is not fixed. It can be changed when parents pay equally attention to all the kids. Another fixed attribute, what we call a fixed attribute, is social economic status. If you are upper class, if you are lower class, I give you just one example also here for a kind of underachievement, which seems to be fixed, but of course it is not fixed. You all know every word you say builds your child's brain. There's a study from the University of Kansas, and maybe you have already heard this expression, the 30 million word gap by age 3. What happens here? You see here, You see, by the age of 12 months, a kid from a low-income family has only heard 3 million words. Working class children, 7 million words, United States data. And profession, what they call profession, this is everyone except working class and low income, 12 million words. When they are 48 months, low-income children have only heard 13 million words. 45 million words, the kids from the other upper-class families. And this translates, of course, in the vocabulary growth of the kids. This is vocabulary growth in the first 3 years. And you see, low social economic status children know less words, use less words, use a more simple language. Is this because they are born like this? Obviously, if parents put more investment into their kids, also low-income kids can go up in their development. I've talked now about gender, birth order, and socioeconomic status, and you see caring parents who have time, who pay attention, can already make a big, big difference in terms of underachievement. Let's look for a fourth reason. This is nation. First of all, there are no intelligence differences between the nations. There are no intelligence differences between the nations. Keep that in mind, please. We can now take a look at the PISA data. The top performing students at PISA, these are on competence levels 5 or 6. They have, for example, these three abilities. They systematically explore a complex problem scenario in the PISA tasks. They devise multiple-step solutions that take into account all constraints and adjust their plans in light of the feedback received. So, on these two highest competence levels across nations in the OECD countries, 15.3% of the students are in these highest competence levels. Best country in this regard is Singapore. Almost 40% are high competence students. Japan, 25.8%. If you look to Germany, we are below 20%. If you go down, United Kingdom, roughly 17%, United States, 13.3%, Hungary, 10.3%. And now you ask, how many high-level students do we have here in Turkey? I hope this is not a shock for you. It's only 1.6%. So think of this. You are as intelligent as the other countries. Those from Singapore are not 20% more intelligent than the German guys. The same intelligence, but they make more of their students. And this is something, of course, this is a heavy task for your country. I'm happy that you are changing now over the last years something in your countries, but you see here, you are, in terms of school achievements, still an underachieving country, and you have to change that. What can you, for example, do? One thing you can do is join with your institution, if you are working for a school, for a university or so, the European Talent Support Network. It was 2011 decided from the European Union, from the Presidential Conference on Talent Support, that something like such a network will be founded. In Ljubljana, 2014, at our conference of the European Council of High Ability, the ECHA, we decided that we will now implement this network, and also an accreditation committee, a committee who decides who is allowed to become part of this network. Because quality standards must be met, of course. Not anybody can take part. You must be convinced that this institution, this school, this parents' association, this university department, whatever, is doing good work. So this is the qualification committee. If you look at the lower right side, you see someone from Turkey is also taking part in this qualification committee. And in the first round, 14 applications have been accepted for a talent center. We had 29 applications, only 14 were accepted. I can see that also one was from Turkey. In the second round of applications, 1 year later, three more talent centers have been accepted. Now we have applied, Heidrun Sturger, you have heard her yesterday, and I. We have now the South German talent center, but also two associated talent centers outside of Europe. This is your Turkish talent center. You see the talent center, the Center for Research and Practice on Gifted Education at Anadolu University. This is here a house. You have even more now in Turkey. You have also some talent points. If your institution is interested to take part in this network, you apply at your talent center at Anadolu University and try to become a member. So, in the meantime, we have the 19 talent centers and more than 300 talent points across Europe. And this month, we start a new call, and we hope that we have then 500, maybe even more, talent points across Europe. You see me here in the middle. This is the first council of the European Talent Support Center. I'm the chairman. On the right side, you see we have also a youth organization, the Youth Summit, and this is the representative of the Youth Summit. This picture was taken in the European Parliament. So Google that and join us. Together, we are stronger. We can, for example, share knowledge about gifted education, about best practices in this network. We can better identify the gifted. We can reach maybe a critical mass. So if you are alone in your school with gifted education, if you go to your government, maybe they just send you back. But if there are 50, 100 talent points in Turkey, you have a voice. And if you have maybe 1,000 talent points all over Europe, you can also have a voice in the European Union. So, this was some fixed attributes, what you can do about it. Let's go to some strong fields, which have a strong influence on underachievement and what you can do. Motivation and self-related cognitions. Just one example, this is Professor Carol Dweck. Now at Stanford University, she did some very nice experiments. And maybe you did that with your children. What is happening when you tell your child she or he is intelligent? So in one study, students were given two intelligence tests. After they had finished the first intelligence test, half of the children heard something like, "Great, you are so intelligent." Gives a nice feeling. If you hear that about you, the other half of the students heard, "Great, you are working well." Does this make a difference? If people say you are intelligent or you are working well. Between the first and the second intelligence test, the students were offered a choice between learning a new problem-solving strategy for the second test or finding out how I'm doing compared to the others. Am I better than the others? But they can only do one of these, a new problem-solving strategy or learn how good the others were. I already know I'm intelligent and I have worked hard. And indeed, students praised for their intelligence chose to find out their class rank rather than to prepare. So they were not interested in learning more. If you hear you are intelligent, you want to hear I'm better than the others. In the second experiment, students received again two intelligence tests. You know this, after the first test, half of the students are praised for their intelligence, you are so intelligent. The other half is praised for the working style, you are working well. And then the students were given a choice of test for the second round. One choice was a test that would be more difficult than the first intelligence test, but the researcher told the kids that they learned a lot from it. The other choice was an easy test, just like the first. And look at this. Those who have been praised for their intelligence didn't want to take the second test, which was more difficult, but they could learn. They want again, in the majority, to take the easy test. In the study 3, students were given again intelligence tests. They heard again, "Great, you are so intelligent," or "Great, you are working well." Then the students were told they can send their result, their IQ, to another student from another school. They do not know this other student. They will never meet this other student. And look at this. Of those praised for their intelligence, 40% gave a higher IQ. They're breaking with an even higher IQ, lied about their IQ. And those who were praised for their hard working usually didn't exaggerate with their IQ. So here I'm intelligent, but it's not enough for me. I tell the others I'm even more intelligent. The last study is a little bit more complicated, but in my view, the most interesting here. Again, you have a first intelligence test, half of the kids. Here, you are so intelligent. The other half, here, you have worked hard. Then kids take a second and a third intelligence test. But the second intelligence test was too difficult. It was an intelligence for older kids. So all kids here had failure. but not so good this time at the second test. Those who were praised for their effort, when they were asked, why did you think you were not so good at this second test, they think they didn't work hard enough. Those who have been praised for their intelligence, when they were asked, why did you do so well at the second test, they think I'm not smart enough. And now we have the third intelligence test. What will happen now? First they had a success, then they had failure. Those who had been praised for their effort, for their working style, significantly improved on the first score by 30%. 30%. Those who'd been praised for their intelligence did worse than they had at the very beginning by about 20%. Clearly, they were underachievers. They could do better. It was the same level, the third test, like the first test, but they went down for 20%. This is, you see here, the power of self-related cognitions. There are many more other effects like this, but get one step further, learning behavior. This is simply the result of students who are good at what we call self-regulated learning and students who are not so good at self-regulated learning. These are the result of a German study, the school grades of them. Our German grading system, one is the best grade, and those on the right side who are good at self-regulated learning are much better in terms of school grades, school achievements, when they are good self-regulated learners. What is meant by self-regulated learning? Very quickly, it's consisting of several skills. It's a cycle. You start and you go through and through and through. First of all, you must know what are your strengths, what are your weaknesses. So this is called self-evaluation. You have a realistic image of what you can, what you cannot. Then you have to set a goal. Some set unrealistically high goals, others low goals. A self-regulated learner sets proper, adequate, appropriate goals. Then you have to do a strategic plan. For example, what learning strategy do I use? Then I have to use this learning strategy. Knowing a learning strategy doesn't help. I have also to practice this learning strategy. Then I have to see if this learning strategy works. If not, I have to adapt this learning strategy, change it a little bit, use it, monitor it. Then, by the end, I have to check the results. You are not so good at the latter. So, for example, am I ready to take this classroom test? Some students are much better. They know when they have enough learned. Others are very optimistic in this and overestimate their abilities. And then this cycle starts anew. So we have done a lot of research on this self-regulated learning. Achievers are better at self-regulated learning. Underachievers, you find very often among them skill deficits in self-regulated learning. When we give workshops for teacher education students, usually a workshop on self-regulated cognitions, like don't make mistakes, like praising the intelligence, but I said there are many, many more these things. Such workshops usually take 2 days, or to change learning behavior in terms of self-regulated learning. Also, such workshops for teachers usually take 2 days. So one can fix that. It takes some time, 2 days. Also, but one can fix that. There's another thing that is very important. That takes not 2 days for teachers. Now we have to work mostly one-to-one with teachers. How can you do that? This is the environment. The environment, the influence of the environment was often underestimated. I introduce now a new term, social talk, that are stable contexts of individual actions. So this sounds very abstract, this sounds still abstract, what we call the objective action space and the normative action space. Objective action space means you can do in every situation of your life many, many things, but not everything. For example, here you can run along the stairs, but not here, because here you have the chairs. They block you. So you cannot run in the middle. But you can run pretty fast the stairs. Normative action space means in every situation, behavior is expected from so many situations. For example, when you are at home, you can start singing, but you would look all a little bit bewildered if you start singing now in this situation. This is the normative action space, what you would usually expect a person to do. We can apply this to learning. The objective action space, we can ask for each situation in your life, was in this situation learning possible or not possible? We can also ask, for each situation of your life, is learning regarded in this situation as positive, as negative, or neither nor? So in this situation, right now, learning would be regarded, of course, as very positive, and it's possible for you to learn something. And we would call such a situation, when learning is possible and is regarded as positive, a learning social code. So, resource rooms in schools are an example, music instrument rooms. There are other situations, learning is possible, but it seems to be a negative thing. For example, sometimes in kindergarten in Germany, parents say, my child should play, not should enjoy herself, should be happy during kindergarten times, not learning. Or in classroom, maybe the others don't like the best in the classroom, a high achiever. There are other situations, learning is possible, but that's neither more like disregarded. So for example, if you grow up in the mountains, should you now learn skiing and be a very good skier, very good at skiing? Or maybe your parents had a lot of books at home, you can read, but you must not read, maybe. There are other situations where it is not possible, but it is regarded as positive. For example, see these girls taking the stairs in the school. And imagine this is your daughter, and her friend says to her, the biology lesson will certainly be terrible. Do you want such a friend for your daughter? Or, wow, I'm looking forward to the biology lesson. Do you want the second one? This is a thematic social talk. They cannot learn on the stairs, but learning is regarded in the second situation as positive. Oh, last one. Question. Okay. Good. Then antagonistic social talk. Learning is not possible and it is regarded as negative, maybe on parties, things like that. Or the biology lesson will be terrible. This is also an antagonistic social talk. Others don't like your learning. Competitive social talk means you cannot learn in this situation. But it is not regarded as positive or negative to learn. For example, when you are swimming, so you cannot learn now for school, is it positive, is it negative? Or maybe in the football stadium, it's too loud, you cannot learn in the football stadium. What do the others think about you if you now stop learning? Probably they don't care. I want to share with you data from a study we did. In this study, we asked teacher, tell us who's the best in your classroom. The best. And tell me one in your classroom, only one in your classroom, who has average achievements, but you think this student has the same potential as the best student in your classroom. We call the second one the high potential, but average achievements, and the first one the best student in class. So, and now we are simply interested, how often are these students in different social talks? We had, I think, around 40 classrooms, so 40 best students in the classroom and 40 with average achievements but high potential. We gave them a plan for a week, and they had to fill in this plan for every day, for Monday, what are they doing from midnight to 1 o'clock in the night, sleeping probably. So we figured out how long are they in the different social topes. Let's look first at learning social topes, and you see here the best student and the high potential student were some hours in learning social topes. The difference here is not significant. They are not the same level here, the same height, the two bars, but the difference is still random, not statistically significant. So we can say they are equally often in learning social topes. What about avoidance social talks? Learning is possible, but the others think we should not learn in this situation. And you see here, the high achievers, they are never, according to them, never in these avoidance social talks, but the high potentials are sometimes. For example, when the teacher was sick, didn't show up to the lesson, what do I do? I can now go out, play football with my friends, but I can also learn. The best students, they learned. They didn't perceive the situation that, like, I should not learn in this situation. Infrastructural social tropes. So, learning is possible, but neither nor, so there's no pressure on me. The best students had the feeling they are much more infrastructural social tropes. Please be aware of this. The situations were in part identical. Both were, for example, on the train commuting to the school. The best students thought, I can learn on the train. If they did really learn, it's something different. This is not the point. The high potential student, he thinks, this is not a situation I can learn, this is a situation I can listen to music. So, those who make it later perceive many more situations as positive situations for learning. Thematic social talks, this is a significant difference. The best students were much more often in situations where they cannot learn, but learning is regarded as positive. They were, as you see here, less in situation, the best students, which they cannot learn, but the others regard learning not as so bad, as bad. They were less in this situation. And competitive situations, swimming, ballet, football, kicking, around the same amount. So, the best students are much more often in favorable social talks and much less in unfavorable social talks. So, the situations in which you be is a good predictor if you be an underachiever or an achiever. So, you have also to work in these situations. So, actually, I didn't think that I have to take some questions, so I prepared some 10 more minutes, but thank you.